Hello everyone, I'm Hugo.
I'm Jake.
It's over. It's finally over. For us at least, not for you. You're about to see it for the first time, but
yeah, especially this is more the first time than the first time, because now instead of a grown man with a dyed blue beard, now we have a 7 foot tall book golem wandering the streets.
For those of you who don't know, we've done this series for quite a long time, and one of the most popular things we've done is the Salty the Singing Songbook series. Ooh. Now, here's the thing. There's only like 5 or 6 of these. We've come to the final one, and this is sort of a special day, so we're gonna do this in the style of the first one we did, where we're just gonna have a little discussion about it and see where it goes, because this one is a little different. You can tell that Debbie and what's-his-face Retino.
Ernie. R.I.P. Ernie.
You can tell after 3 or so of these...
I think he's alive.
Okay, that's good. 3 or so of these Kids Praise DVDs, yeah. I feel like they maybe run out of money. Or they were on their last legs or something, or they really decided, okay, this isn't working. We've made 3 or 4 things, they haven't become popular. Maybe we need to really put some money into this and do a pilot for a TV show so it can be as popular as Colby, which had like 20 or so and was on the TBN network.
I have to ask, chronologically speaking, where's the dog?
Okay, we get the first 3 where they're just in the clubhouse, okay. Then the camp where they're with the dog,
okay.
Then this one. So the
dog. There's 5.
The dog.
There's 5 live action. They have a bunch of albums.
Yeah, but the albums are mostly just stuff that we hear in the shows and stuff.
Sure.
But they have their own storylines and whatever, because kids' records that are biblical tend to have like little storylines or whatever.
Sure.
Because I guess they think kids will like the songs better if there's a narrative. anyway. At this point, it seems that they're like, okay, creepy book guy not working. It needs to be an actual book. So it appears to me that they spent the time and maybe took out some loans. I don't know this to be a fact, but this did not financially work out for them. But they spent the time and money to get an actual animatronic book suit.
Is it time to reveal it?
Let's give it a second. First, I want to point out that they did this under Quiet Time Productions, which I think is the most blatant way you can say, okay, kids, we're going to put on a stupid VHS, shut the fuck up.
Quiet Time.
That's a good way to tell parents, buy this, your kids will shut up for a little while. And I don't know what year this came out, I'll put it on screen, but I'm guessing it came out after Indiana Jones.
Because, well, definitely the 80s. If this made it into the 90s, I'd be very surprised.
Yeah, it's a complete non sequitur. They start in the jungle. Because Salty, when I think about a giant book man, I think about the African jungle. And it is Africa, they say later.
Yeah, it's established African jungle, which would explain these brown tan people.
Oh, God.
It's pretty bad. I really think, okay, wait, no. Let's just, you're going in dry, okay? I mean, I guess we kind of lube, we spit on it a little bit, but certainly no water-based lubricant here, okay? We just have to give you, like, the first little bit of this, because there's really no way to describe it.
Looks like you were right. We should have followed the river after all. Say, have any of you gentlemen seen a suspicious-looking character lurking around here lately? How did we get ourselves into this mess?
So, at least he's blue. It's not a white savior thing.
Here's the thing. This movie has the same opening as Thor Ragnarok in the sense that it starts with him. It starts with them hanging upside down and going, I wonder how I got into this situation.
Without any of the charm.
So then we flash back.
Okay.
We're out of the jungle. That's the last we're going to see of the jungle until the very end of this.
Yeah.
And Salty, Charity Church Mouse, and mm-hmm. his child harem. I don't even know what? This time, I don't even want to call it a child harem, because Jake and I talked about this during the production. The lack of human head on Salty, at this point, my canon reason that he looks like this now is that at some point he had, like, a... You ever seen Stephen King's Thinner?
I was gonna say he's being Cronenberg.
Okay.
So it's kinda like The Fly in that he slowly goes from man to book, and he's sort of resorbed into the book form. So that, like, because he has a human face in, like, all of the other versions of this, and sometimes they get really bad, it kind of feels like if the human face is gone, the human pedophile penis is also gone.
See,
so that's pretty good.
I was thinking Stephen King's Thinner, where he, like, went onto a Native American, like, reservation and was trying to spread the word, and he accidentally killed some Native American's kid.
Isn't that...
And he goes, take this blue book from town.
Why does Stephen King do that? Pet Cemetery, same thing.
Yeah. Native Americans, ooh.
Ooh, spooky. Spooky brown folks.
You think if, I'm pretty sure if Nazi Germany had won the war and they had made movies up until, like, the 1990s, there would have been a bunch of movies about ancient Jewish burial grounds. Ooh, a golem's coming after us.
Literally, Salty's a golem.
Yeah. Anyway. So, they're having Salty's Salvation Celebration. This is called, by the way, Salty's Salvation Celebration, the movie.
Yeah.
And the premise of which is that they are traveling from town to town.
Via train!
Yeah, they bought Amtrak tickets, which is nice. It's the 90s. You're not going to get stabbed on the train yet. But, fuck. At the very least, this was less tedious than the previous episodes, because the previous episodes were all in that clubhouse, and it was all very much the same. At the very least, this... like, it's a single camera show, so it's jumping around. It looks, for lack of a better term, more cinematic.
It really does. They do a few establishing shots that are, I don't know, and they do some, like, some cuts, and it feels a little more active, and that's pretty good. It's visually much more interesting. This was a 37 minute runtime, roughly. Yeah. Felt like 15, 20 minutes?
Surprisingly, right? Compared to the other ones, it was a breezy sit-through because, like, stuff was going on, there was a plot.
Oh my god, and they had just about as many songs, but it didn't feel nearly as bad because there's, like, stuff going on during the songs that they'll cut away to in between.
And the, like, songs aren't all on the same exact set, so... Like, there's one... Like, normally we just have them in the clubhouse, and they're just, like, dancing around, doing whatever the choreography. There were some at least different ideas here. There's one where they're on the train, and they're all kind of in a line, and they're doing stuff. Like, it's not great or anything, but it's different, and that's something.
I'm gonna say this without any, like, twinge of sarcasm or judgment... This is Debbie and Ernie Rutino's magnum opus.
I'm gonna agree with that.
This is their absolute best effort.
In fairness, you haven't seen High Tops yet.
No, I haven't. That was after, though, right?
I think so. I think that was more a 90s thing. We'll get to that.
You can peek. That's fine.
We also get introduced to, I guess, the main character of this.
Sort of.
Shelly.
She might have less screen time than the villain.
Yeah, I think so.
Oh, there you are, Shelly. I didn't think I'd seen you yet. Wow, you just made it.
Yeah, we're running a little late today. Salty...
If I didn't know you better, I'd say you're a little nervous about this trip.
Well, maybe a little.
Shelly is introduced, and she's, as far as Salty is concerned, the best singer in his child harem. We hear her later, and...
you know, yeah.
She's doing her best.
Yeah, she seems like she's having fun. I'm not gonna shit on the kid, necessarily.
But it appears she has...
I'm not R. Kelly.
Sure. She has a problem where she is fine singing, but she doesn't like to go up on stage and actually talk about Jesus. She's uncomfortable with public speaking, which, frankly, I'm 25 and I feel the same way. I'm not 9 years old.
I suppose. So. You know, it's just kind of her weird arc. And it doesn't seem... it's a 36-minute runtime. It doesn't seem like, again, like any Christian show ever really, like, has real arcs for characters.
No.
I think you could very easily have made this a little bit better by having her try a couple times and failing to talk to people. But really, there's like one scene where kids talk at her, and then she leaves and is like, well, I thought about telling them about Jesus, but I didn't.
I don't understand the words to that song. What does it mean to be born again?
Charity, look. Shelley has a chance to share the gospel with Ralph and Rhonda.
Shelley, it has always been my contention that Christian kids are, well, quite frankly, nerds. But this group is presenting me with a very different picture. You all seem to be having such a delightful time. How does one become involved in a program such as this?
Yeah, I want to join too.
Uh-oh. Shelley, don't tell them about the Lord.
I presume being born again is a prerequisite?
Well, it's not that easy for me to put it into the right words.
Albuquerque Station, 5 minutes.
Shelley, we have to practice.
And it's like, that's not a failure. That's just not bringing up your fucking religion to these kids. And I think that, I don't know, there's never any, like, even social, real social stakes. Like, McGee and Me does a better job of putting stakes in a show, and that has none.
Yeah. So they get on the Amtrak train, and they decide they're going to go to Albuquerque for the long-awaited Breaking Bad salty crossover we've all been waiting for.
It blew all the way down. Do you think Blue's Clues will also be there?
No, Steve has...
Steve is there, though. That's where he gets... That's why he quit.
Oh, he got addicted to the meth. Okay.
He likes to snort it.
Okay. So, they get on the train, and they're introduced to the villain of the episode, and I presume if this had been picked up for series by TBN or whoever, this would have been the series' regular villain.
Yeah.
And they even set up that he's like, I'm a master of disguise, kind of like Robbie Rotten from Lazytown.
Yeah. This guy's actor name is Rob Rigg, by the way, with 2 B's and 2 G's.
Oh, okay.
Rob Rigg.
Yeah, that's not the worst actor name I've ever heard.
This is one of 2 credits to his name on IMDb. The other is from High Tops.
Of course. It is. This villain's name has 2 names, I guess. His fake name is Ricky Rasmussen, and his real villain name is Risky Rat. And this is, like, next to the bad guy from Pocahontas.
They see how I do it.
Probably the gayest coded villain I've ever seen.
This is going to be the worst tour that Salty and Charity have ever had. Ricky Rasmussen, what a brilliant disguise. Well, what do you expect from a genius?
It's really gay coded. We were talking about this during when we were watching it. It reminds us of like how gay coded the Bible Man guy was. And also the problem of him being better than anybody else on the show.
Who's the brand new evil in your town?
Shadow of Doubt.
Who's the baddest bad guy all around?
Shadow of Doubt.
Who's got the plan to take you down?
Shadow of Doubt.
Who's both the verb and the noun?
Shadow of Doubt.
I talked about this while we were watching this. Bible Man, I watched as a kid and I loved it. But I think they made a grave mistake in that the most interesting and funnest part of those episodes was the bad guy.
Yeah, every time.
Who were always atheists. And
he had the best songs.
Yeah, so maybe that's why I don't believe. That guy was just too...
He's too convincing.
Yeah.
But yeah, the makeup on here is incredibly unsettling. Luckily, it's in 360p and... You literally can't get a better copy of this if you order a DVD.
360p was like the 90s' Instagram filter. It kind of smooths over everything.
Yeah, it also makes it feel less tangible. So you're kind of like, this might be just be like a fever dream.
Yeah.
And so it kind of, it goes away for you. It's not as haunting. But boy, he stands out several times. It's not just because he has the gay-coded voice either. He just kind of has, like, better lines. I don't know if this guy, like improvised or whatever, but it felt like... For some reason, he's the only one that ever talks to the camera.
Oh, they're not... It's not just fourth wall breaks. He has his own little Shakespearean asides.
Yeah.
Are you keeping score out there? Let's review, shall we? First, I irritated Salty and Charity from day one. Second, I upset the teamwork and cooperation amongst the kids. Third, I got Shelley to doubt her faith in the Lord. Fourth, I stopped Ralph and Rhonda from receiving Jesus as their savior. And fifth, I'm ruining the final show by borrowing these tapes.
People don't realize how much hard work goes into being a good villain.
This is high art right here. It's fucking amazing.
It's a lot.
Anyway, his scheme is to try and get the kids, or at least he claims he's going to pay the kids like $6,000 over like 3 months or something.
2 weeks.
Oh, 2 weeks?
Two weeks.
That's pretty good.
I think it was $144,000 a year, I think.
Yeah. He says he's like a talent agent and he wants them to continue to sing like kids praise songs, but he wants to pay them to do it. It turns out this is all a scheme that makes no sense, though, because he's lying to them.
He's basically trying to poach Salty's talent.
But the thing is,
it ruins the shows.
But the thing is, what's his end game here? What's his like final fruition of the plan? Because he's never gonna get the kids away from Salty for long enough for them to like be tricked, because he's not paying them. Is he just trying to poach his child harem, literally? Like Ricky
Rat? I don't think Ricky Rat's interested in children. For some reason I didn't get a pedo vibe at all from the guy.
No.
He just really fucking doesn't like the book. He doesn't like that guy. Maybe he's trying to save the kids, honestly.
Maybe. Ricky's the secret underdog hero of the Salty franchise. All right.
So, this is where you're hiding. Ever since I got on this train, everybody's been telling me about this group of talented young performers.
Excuse me, but...
No apology is necessary, my good friend. Everybody forgets my name. You see, my job is making other people famous.
Charity Church Mouse, as we mentioned before, is in this as well,
by
the way.
For some reason,
her voice, I think, was...
It's dubbed.
It's...
I think it's Debbie Rutino, because she doesn't look like that.
At that point, we move to the left on the next line. Okay, let's start again. 1, 2, 3.
Born again! Born again!
Charity, I'm sure the kids will be just fine. Don't you think it's time to give them a little break?
Oh my, I'm such a slave driver. Well, you all deserve a rest. But remember, Zach, to the right, to the right.
Yeah.
So she's dubbing the voice from the poor actress that actually... By the way, Ernie's not in the suit either. It's some other person. But Ernie's doing the voice as well. And it's puppeted by somebody. I don't know.
I don't know who they got to make the suit itself and do the animatronics. I mean, it's not great. It's like, have you ever seen Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles Coming Out of Our Shells tour?
That's what we're doing here, dudes! We're bringing our music to all who will listen! And what do you think the first song we wrote was? That's right! It's about the one thing that really gets us going!
Yeah, and it doesn't matter whether it's Sicilian or regular,
deep dish or extra thin,
by the slice or by the pie.
What is it?
Pizza!
Yeah. The animatronics remind me a little bit of that, but actually a little bit better, so whoever did it.
Corey Feldman's best role.
I commend them for putting any amount of effort into something Salty related.
It's better than Colby.
Yes. Yes. Absolutely.
So, it sounds like we liked this. I didn't really like this.
This is like the...
Didn't hate it.
Yeah. Weirdly, I think the animatronic suit was probably their downfall in this not getting picked up to series, because the maintenance on that and the operation expenses, I think, actually probably hurt them in the long run.
It was an actual robot.
Yeah. Unlike Colby, who is just Salty in a robot suit also, so we can double
as well.
So we can double up on child harems.
Oh god.
Anyway, so after there's a little bit of a villain song where it's introduced that the villain is not Ricky Rasmussen, he's Risky Rat, but it starts almost like sympathy for the devil, or he's like,
yeah, we thought it was the devil, we thought he was gonna be Devil Rat.
He's like, please allow me to introduce myself, you know my name.
Wanna play a game? Can you guess my name? It's a fun game, so come on and play. Ready? Here goes. I am the master of disguises. I'm never who you think. I'm clever, cruel, conniving. A creep, a real rat fink. Can you guess yet?
But like,
No one did.
It's not Satan, and
it's just a rat guy.
He's just a rat.
And so that was weird.
Yeah. So some nerdy kids show up, one of which at least is played by the daughter of Debbie Rutino.
By the way, gay!
Yeah, she's a lesbian. Good for you. Still a Christian, though. But, you know, at least you're inclusive and all that, so that's nice. And Shelley. I forgot her name for a second. How could I forget Shelley? What an impression that character made.
Yeah. So there's two nerdy kids, and you can tell because they dress weird and talk funny.
At the risk of sounding disingenuous, I must say that you are a most talented performer.
You're the very best one out there.
And they are interested in a where are their parents? Did they just join this train?
Yeah.
Are they hobos?
Maybe. I hate the boy character because he does that, like, kids character thing where he's so precious. He just talks like he doesn't...
Was that supposed to be precious?
I don't... Yeah.
Is it supposed to be cute?
I think
so. Oh, it makes me want to punch him in the face.
Right. I don't know if this kid actually has a speech impediment or if they had to, like, tell him to talk like this, but I hate when they do this in shows.
Just say a hard R. it's pretty easy.
So, Shelley is supposed to proselytize to these kids. She can't do it. This is part of her arc. Don't care at all.
Yeah, I don't. I'm trying to think of a part that I care about between these characters.
See, this is the part where I started to get a little bored and we started to think about, like, okay, this is actually a culmination of what we've seen from the previous Salty things. The canon's a little bit different and the book is an actual book. But at the end of the day, like, they brought back Charity Church Mouse. Yep. Like, they established they're on tour and stuff. It seems like a continuation of what's
coming before. I still think it is a continuation. His disease has just progressed.
Sure. But, at this point, I started to think, why didn't they bring the creepy dog from the camp episode back?
Prison?
That's why they're going to Albuquerque.
Yeah, to visit him. It's visitation.
Oh, okay.
He gets a little bit of a conjugal in the summer months. And so, you know, Salty's going to bring some kids down, see what happens, see if he can get them by. You know, maybe, you know, hide something in his butt or something. You know, you never know how this is going to work out.
Okay.
You've never been to prison. You don't know how it's rough. It's rough. Especially dog prison.
It's especially rough.
Was that a dog joke?
Yeah.
Because dogs...
Rough. So next, there's a song in the park. This looks like they actually shot this at, like, a live event they were going to, which is nice, I guess.
Was it real?
I don't know.
I can't tell. Because they kind of use the same set for, like, two different locations?
I guess, but it was an appropriate audience size for a free Christian kids concert in the park.
Oh, yeah. Like, it's my weekend with the kids, Tina. I'm gonna take them to the park. And then there happens to be a Christian thing going on, and you're like, fuck it. I guess I can smoke my pack over here and watch the kids from afar.
The train was behind them, though.
The train was behind them. No park is adjacent to a train yard. That's incredibly dangerous. You know what? What if your kids are like, I'm going to swing and then let's go play in the tracks? And then they fucking get smooshed to smithereens.
So does this mean that Salty owns that train, that he can just make it stop wherever he wants?
I think he probably owns a train. That's probably where a lot of the budget went, is like... We have to own a train. And Debbie's like, Ernie, why? I've always wanted a train, Deborah. You've known this since you married me. This was the deal. And then he slaps one of his kids. Turns out to be the one in the show. She's like, Dad, don't make me go. She's like, you're going to be the nerd now. And that's my headcanon for how this was done. That's my head. It's abuse. This is just a front for abuse.
So then the kid talks about how she's a dirty, dirty sinner and the only one who can save her is Jesus. Pretty par for the course for the Salty episodes.
Hi, everybody. My name is Danielle, and I am 10 years old. I never thought myself as a sinner until last year. I found out for sure that I was one. We all are. The Bible says all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. Well, you can't imagine how shocking this news was to me.
Shelley tells Salty, hey, I'm having some issues, and Ricky is offering me a bunch of money. You made my parents pay for cross-country and track tickets. We're very poor.
Yeah.
Please let me go home, or I need to go work for Ricky Rat. And Salty's like, I don't think so.
Meeting Mr. Rasmussen on this train tour can't just be a coincidence.
Yes. Shelley. Being in a professional show and starring in a TV special could be wonderful if that's what God has in mind for you. But we're concerned about what's going on inside your heart right now.
We know you've been too nervous to talk to Ralph and Rhonda about the Lord, but they really admire you. We think you can be the person to lead them to Jesus.
Well, you know, I just... personally, for me, at the time... I mean, think about the context, right? Yeah. It's a child actor in the 90s. JonBenet Ramsey just happened. You probably want a little independent money, right? Just in case.
Yeah, sure.
You never know.
I wasn't expecting JonBenet Ramsey to come up during this.
Well, no one else is either, because she's dead.
So, Risky Rat steals the master tapes for Salty Nine.
Okay. The implication with the master tapes is that those are the tapes that they play the music on
and they
to do the shows.
They even say, like, what are we going to do? We can't play and the concert is, like, delayed.
Excuse me, Sam, have you seen my tapes?
I haven't seen them.
Are you out there? It's 10 o'clock, but no one can hear me.
Oh no.
Hey, right, for like a few minutes,
but
right?
Like, they're still on the train at the time it's delayed, yeah. So it's like, you guys were going to be late either way. But then they just come on the stage and impromptu do a song.
Without the tapes, so they didn't need the tapes, so they're pointless. The tapes immediately lose all impact. Like, what if, I think it'd be much better if they were like, you know, what can we do? And then one of the kids goes, I got an idea, Salty, and he goes, and then someone else goes,
yeah, okay.
And then they do an acapella thing. Come on, Ernie, hire me.
Anyway, so then after that happens, the plot of the song, by the way, makes no sense to the audience.
I don't actually remember the song.
The song is like, Ricky Rat stole our song.
Oh, yeah, so if you're not a part of the train group, everybody else is just like, can we get some context?
Yeah.
Risky stole the master tape. Salty's Nine has disappeared. Got the last laugh, but let me just make one thing clear.
Can we have some, who's Richard Rat? Richard?
This is also where we hear Shelly sing, and she's,
we'll let you be the judge.
Along came Risky Rat, thinking he was oh so smart, telling me his lies, tearing up my tender heart.
I'm not a good singer.
Yeah.
I mean, that kid certainly in 1993 sang better than I did.
Oh, yeah.
So.
Not worth $6,000 every 2 weeks. Anyway. Yeah. So then she finally gets the confidence to convert the nerds by saying some kinky shit, frankly.
Oh. We've all been selfish and disobeyed God, and we deserve to be punished. But it's sort of like our best friend stepped up and took the punishment for us.
Wow, Jesus did that for me? He must really love us.
So, Ricky Rat, or Risky Rat, or whatever the fuck his name is, exits the building, is about to get in a taxi cab, and has a Shakespearean aside to say, where am I going to go with these tapes? Africa sounds nice.
What?
So,
did they have VCRs in 80s Africa? Like, where he's going in the middle of the jungle?
I don't know. I'm assuming he just took the cab all the way to Africa. It's the same cab that drove Will Smith from Philadelphia to Bel Air or wherever the fuck.
What was the fair?
The fair? What was the
F-A-R-E. The cab fare. That's a lot.
I think Ricky just killed the cab driver after he got there.
Oh, I was talking about Will Smith.
Oh.
I was talking about Will Smith.
I think Will Smith just killed the cab driver after he got to Bel Air.
That's the answer. Was Will Smith... I thought Will Smith was leaving to escape violence. No. There, you got roughed up on the basketball court. Remember when the guy spun him around?
Yeah.
Anyway, so this isn't about the Fresh Prince or DJ Jazzy Jeff. But career trajectory is very similar. So the mouse is now in the jungle. And so that means weirdest fucking ending.
This is where we come back to where we began. Because the episode began in the jungle,
yep,
at the ending. And then it flashed back.
And
so we
by this time, we had like 4 minutes of runtime by this time. And I thought, like, maybe we get like a little bit of a thing.
Yeah. So Salty is now hanging upside down above a cooking pot, because as we all know, people who live in Africa are cannibals or eat books, whatever. The kids are nowhere to be found.
The kids were right next to him.
Oh, were they?
They were just standing there, watching him being cooked.
Maybe the kids are just finally thinking, thank you for saving us, we've been
and
trapped.
Then, and then, like a Street Fighter character on Idol, one of the guys is just going like this with a spear.
I feel so bad for the people who had to play the, like, African cannibal people. Oh, my God. And then...
they're wearing, like, big fucking mask things?
Salty, being the genius he is, the Retinos made a bold choice here.
Okay.
They decided to have Salty say...
So, that's how we got into this mess. Any ideas how to get out of it? I'm just trusting that the Lord will work it out. That risky rat is not gonna stop us. We'll climb the highest mountain, swim the deepest sea. We'll find the missing nine, because kids have got to learn how to get to know the Lord better.
To be continued.
So,
except...
bad news. They said that before they got anything, as far as a sequel's concerned, funded. They even gave it a title, something like something Kids, The Search for the Nine or something, and that apparently has never been a thing.
That never materialized, meaning...
So, Salty's story ends here.
Salty gets eaten by those fucking cannibals!
And I imagine those children,
yeah,
including Shelly,
yeah,
all dead! 100% dead and gone. Just like JonBenet Ramsey! Very similar... endings, different circumstances. It was her dad.
Salty may be the best thing I've ever seen in my entire life. It has the most interesting extended canon.
Yeah?
It has the most... How bold of a children's Christian TV show to end by murdering the main character. Not on purpose, but that's what happened. And... I think the world's a little bit brighter of a place, having known that. So,
that's the end of Salty.
Salty died the way he lived, watching a bunch of kids
stare at him in horror.
Yeah.
So let's take a moment, bow our heads, and
moment of silence.
Moment of a little in memorandum. Here's an in memorandum. Montage to remember our friend, Salty the Songbook. So, this does, of course, lead to an obvious choice by us, since this is the end of the series. Much like Ernie and Debbie Rutino, we would like to announce the launching of the Salty Extended Universe. It's going to include things like Bible Man. Okay, he's going to be our Tony Stark.
Oh, yeah. Okay. Tech guy. Okay.
Tech guy.
He even has Coates will come back.
Colby will be the first villain. He'll be Ultron. Okay.
Okay.
Yeah, and then we'll bring back McGee and me. They can be, fuck it. It's not Marvel, but the Wonder Twins.
Okay.
Sure. I mean, you know, we can do whatever we want. Okay? They have powers. He could draw a gun into...
Okay.
It's going to be rated R for sure. Who else do we have? I mean, Salty's definitely going to come back, probably as a Force ghost, so bring in Star Wars. And he'll put the, we need a Mary Sue. We need a Mary Sue so that the Quartering makes a video about it. So we can drum up some extra business.
The girl from Secret Adventures, which you aren't aware of, but she's nope. Also a thing.
Deal. See, we've already got this going on. Oh, and, I mean, Jesus Christ.
Can the Donut Man be their...
The Donut Man can be Nick Fury.
I was going to
say that. He can wear a donut over his eye.
I'm down. Okay.
Yeah.
And the villain is just Satan. Just straight Satan.
Right, right. First phase is Ultron Colby. And then they find out that is just a puppet from Satan. Which, again, it's just Satan. He's going to, like, bleed from every orifice and like, actually kill people. It's going to be great.
It'll be Tim Curry Satan from Legend.
Oh, my God. Tim Curry? I didn't know he had the butt. Well, he's a little rickety now. It's fine.
Post-stroke Tim Curry, you get a discount. Half off. That's a stroke joke. Anyway, so that's Salty. Thanks, everyone, for...
Bill Cosby from prison as a Hannibal Lecter.
Thanks, everyone! For sticking with us through this series.
Yeah.
If you're concerned about content, don't worry. There's 20 more episodes of Colby that we have to get through.
Are we going to go in order for those?
I don't know.
I feel like building a canon is probably best.
There's a fucking anorexia episode I really want to do.
Yikes.
So, you can always send us more things to review here at the P.O. Box.
Yeah, if you send us something real fucking weird, it might end up... here in a full special, or it could end up on the wheel of things we don't want to fucking watch, but you make us watch because you're bad people who try to hurt us. You could also subscribe to the channel and make sure that you press a meaningless button that doesn't affect anything on YouTube at all.
You can always donate to our Patreon campaign if you want to help support the show. Link in the description. If you can or don't want to do that, you can always share the video to try and help support the channel that way. That's free. You can always...
But if you do want to go the paid route, a single dollar will get you access to things early whenever they become demonetized on YouTube.
Which is often.
Is about 80%. So you might be watching this in its unmonetized form. Who knows? No idea.
You can always follow us on Twitter at PapaBirdJake and at Hugo Reloaded.
Yes, you can watch us argue with real dumb folks at 3 a.m.
So, I guess that's it. If we were smart, we would have had an ending where we are hanging over a pot.
Next time, we'll watch the next episode of Salty. Wait, we can hang over a pot. This will be me. Wait, we have chibis. Grab you. Hold on. I'll be back.
I have a... Hold on.
No, I have a trash can.
We can be hanging over a copy of Space Jam.
Okay. Hanging over a copy of Space Jam, hanging over a cop... Well, no, put it up. Sure. And then, there we go. That's us. We did it. We did a bit. Leave.